So, the 2010s. What is there to say about the 2010s? This was a weird fucking decade. What a crazy 10 years, huh? I mean, I know it mostly feels like that because I've lived most of my life throughout this decade, but it's been such a turbulent and interesting time for culture and the world as a whole, and to see it evolve over 10 years is just, it's really something to behold. Like, no matter what you might think of today's culture or the culture of yesteryear, it's still always interesting to see it grow and change over time. I mean, we started the decade like this.
Shawty's like a melody in my head that I can't keep on, got me singing like na 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 every day.
And we started the new decade like this. Clearly, we have evolved and progressed a lot in the past 10 years, especially in terms of popular music.
Wake up in the morning feeling like P. Diddy.
Hey, what up, girl?
Grab my glasses, I'm out the door, I'm gonna hit this city.
Music this decade has just been one wild ride, one switch up of genre and style and entire, like, super trend, like, after another. I mean, at the start of the 2010s, you had the club boom, which died out around 2012, 2013, when EDM took over for a little while, and a lot of indie songs mixed in there too. And then 2015 was kind of the last year with all the happy and upbeat stuff, a bit of a mix of everything. And then 2016 onward, you had a lot of moody and downbeat stuff. 2017 kind of had that too, but went back on track a little bit. With more happy stuff, it was kind of another mixed bag there. And then 2018 was just super trap dominated all the way through. And then 2019 was just an enigma that is yet to be rationalized by science. And throughout the decade, there were 116 songs that at some point during the past 10 years sat at the number one spot on the Hot 100. So any song that was number one from January 1st, 2010 to December 31st, 2019, I will be ranking all 116 of them in this ranking. Yeah. And if you want to know what songs I'm ranking specifically, I will leave a link to the Wikipedia list of all the songs that hit number one in the 2010s in the description. I will also be arranging the songs into tiers of quality, ranging from reprehensible to all-time favorites. And just remember, this is just my opinion, and feel free to disagree with me. I mean, my taste is probably terrible anyways. And also remember that I did not pick the songs that are on this list. These are just the number one hits according to Billboard, and I did not choose what was going to be here. I only chose the order that the songs will appear in this ranking. And with all that being said, let's begin.
Someone that's afraid to let go. You decide if you're ever gonna let me know. Yeah, suicide if you ever try to let go.
Well, at least there was only one number one hit this decade that I found to be truly reprehensible, but it's just a shame that it happens to be XXXTentacion's biggest hit. And while I don't like to speak ill of the dead, this song just had to be in the reprehensible tier because it is built on one of the most toxic and unnerving lyrical sentiments that I've ever heard in a song.
Suicide if you ever try to let go.
That is easily one of the worst and most toxic lines that I've ever heard in any song, especially a song to hit number one on the charts. The fact that this song has become an anthem for so many people is just disturbing and disgusting in ways that I don't even know how to describe. And while I may like the beat, there's no forgiving that lyrical sentiment in any capacity, and I truly do think that this was the worst of any number one hit that we had in the 2010s.
Justice sure as the hand of God, they brought death to my hometown. They brought death to my hometown.
And I'd sadly close my eyes.
Shut the fuck up. Nobody wants to hear it. Nobody will ever want to hear it. Nobody cares. And the fact that you thought someone might care is honestly baffling to me.
Six.
This song is literally just every bad element of early 2010s pop music crammed together into one clusterfuck of a song. I almost just used the Shut the Fuck Up Guy clip again just to get the point across, because honestly, that's exactly how I feel about this song. Oh, what the hell was she thinking?
I don't like your little games, don't like.
How did anyone think that this was a good idea? I legitimately don't understand what Taylor was thinking when she did this. This song has already been thoroughly picked apart by pretty much everyone on the internet, and it's no wonder. It's pretty much a disaster, a train wreck in every single way. I'm glad she's moved on from this though, but it's really embarrassing to look back on. Yeah, just like with Look What You Made Me Do, I have absolutely no clue what the hell they were trying to do on this song. This is literally just Boom Boom Pow, but like with all the production elements being like way more annoying and way worse. It's pretty much already been forgotten, and that's for the best.
I'm sexy and I know it.
I actually don't hate the song at all. I can't muster up even a single ounce of hatred for this. It is really, really obnoxious, and it is probably, no, definitely the stupidest song to go to number one this decade, so I'm gonna put it here, even though I don't really hate it at all. It is very nostalgic though, I'll give it that. That one line just pretty much guaranteed this a spot in the terrible tier. I already didn't like the attitude and everything of this song, and I actually did make a worst list for 2019, and this was number 7 on that worst list, coincidentally. But yeah, that one line is just, it's fucking terrible. Jesus Christ, Ariana, you can do way better than this, as we will see later. And yeah, you might have guessed, I really do not like toxic attitudes and sentiments in songs, which is why so many of them are super, super low on this list. And we probably still got some more to come, so yeah.
Did I disappoint you? Or leave a bad taste in your mouth?
Do the Harlem Shake.
Bruh.
This song is just a chore to listen to. It's bitter, it's pissy. Halsey's vocals are some of the worst that she's done, maybe ever, and it's just so overwrought and melodramatic. I just can't understand how this became such a big hit in 2019 when everything was generally much more diverse and upbeat. Luckily, Halsey has put out better stuff since this song came out, and hopefully she continues to do so.
Everybody get up.
I don't like where this is going.
Stop! Stop!
No, 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 no! Please, Larry, you don't understand. You don't know what you're doing here.
Man, Bruno must have had some serious squirrels in his pants when he was writing this song.
Because you know I'm all about that bass, no trouble. I'm all about that bass, no trouble.
Meghan Trainor's music-making career was a mistake. I mean, I don't hate the way this sounds, but this is what kickstarted her success in the mainstream, so yeah.
There's girls like you run around with guys like me till sundown. When I come through, I need a girl like you, yeah, yeah.
This song is much more mediocre than bad, but it's the fifth biggest hit of the decade, and I am not okay with that. So, bad tier it is.
So you wanna play with magic? Boy, you should know what you're falling for.
It completely baffles me that this is Katy Perry's biggest hit, because this is easily the most disjointed and weird, awkward mess of a song that she's ever made. I actually kind of like the pre-chorus, but the rest of the song, once that ugly trap beat hits and Juicy J's verse and everything else, is just really bad. Ugh.
If you love like that.
The fact that this song was picked as a single and it hit number one over Style or Wildest Dreams is just honestly a travesty. It also completely underutilizes Kendrick Lamar, and this song accounts for half of the weeks that he spent at number one this decade, and I just can't forgive that. I actually almost bumped this down to the bad tier because this hit number one, but DJ's Got Us Falling in Love Again didn't. And that is a travesty on every level. Okay, I take back what I said about Sexy and I Know It. This is the stupidest song to ever hit number one this decade. Can you blow my I would say that Flo Rida's success in the early 2010s baffles me, but honestly, he's not very dissimilar to any of the other major pop rappers of the time. But you know what? I'll give him this. He can write a catchy goddamn hook, even if it's for the worse, like in this song. This is just autopilot Katy Perry. But unlike a lot of her other songs, it's just not that catchy or fun. It's more monotonous and droning, and it's very similar to Kelly Clarkson's empowerment anthem from just the year before. Oh, speaking of which.
What doesn't kill you makes you stronger. Stand a little taller. Doesn't mean I'm lonely when I'm alone.
Once again, this is just the default of the artist. This is default Kelly Clarkson. Nothing about it is particularly bad, nothing about it is really all that good, but it's much more catchy than Roar, and I think a lot more memorable, so I put it higher.
DJ Khaled. Yeah, you're looking at the truth, the money never lie, no, I'm the one, yeah.
It is unreal how this song manages to remain so thoroughly forgettable and mediocre, despite how many varying artists are on it, of like all different styles. Like, it's really mind-boggling. I will never be able to wrap my head around that.
Grab somebody sexy, tell them, hey, give me everything tonight.
Okay, first of all, the fact that this was the number one hit that was a collaboration between Pitbull and Neo and not Time of Our Lives is a tragedy all in of itself. And second of all, the synth line is really bad. It's very weak and it does not support anything else in the direction or their voices or the subject matter or anything. And it really bogs the song down a lot.
What would I do without your smart mouth? Drawing me in and you kicking me out.
This song is boring. It's very, very drab. I'm glad that John Legend has gone back to making fun music, but it is very much a shame that this is his biggest hit.
Say, little bitch, you can fuck with me if you wanted to. These expensive, these is red bottoms.
I mean, I don't really have a detailed explanation for this one. I just kind of never really got into this song. I think I just find the beat a little too monotonous. I mean, it's not really that bad, but eh.
I'm in love with the shape of you. We push and pull like a magnet do.
Yeah, I like shapes too, Ed.
Damn, I ain't be going psycho. Lil' mama bad like Michael. Can't really trust nobody with all this jewelry on you.
Well, I'll give him this. This is probably the most psychotic lullaby I've ever heard. I mean, that's gotta count for something, right? This is the most half-assed apology I've ever heard. I could say more, but eh, that's about it. The fact that this is Selena Gomez's only number one hit is honestly to be expected, but it's still really disappointing. Of course, of all of the Katy Perry singles from 2012 that became hits, this one was the one that went to number one. Not Wide Awake, which had superior production and lyrics, not The One That Got Away, which had superior lyrics but not really production, this one, the one that has generic production and generic lyrics. Why am I not surprised?
Darling, you look perfect tonight.
I have no idea what the fuck this is, but I don't really actually mind Katy's weird shouty voice that much, but Kanye's verses on this song are so stupid.
Pockets on Shrek, rockets on dick. Tell me what's next, alien sex.
And honestly, I am kinda happy that this is his only number one hit this decade because it's honestly hilarious. I don't really know what I don't like about this. I think it's mainly the production that bothers me. Everything just kind of sounds over cluttered and like really loud and compressed. I don't know. It just feels like it's squeezed into too small of a space for it to really work and breathe and let the whole mood and atmosphere of the song actually shine through. I mean, I kind of get that that may have been the point to juxtapose a song called Pillow Talk with really loud and not pillowy at all sounding production, but eh. I think it detracts from the song more than it adds to it.
Just get ready for work, 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 work. You send me heavy work, 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 work.
This is probably Rihanna's most generic, I guess, hit of the decade. It really does fit the mood of 2016 though, I'll give it that. And her and Drake's chemistry has always been good. But on this song, she really does sound like she's about to fall asleep, and that's just not really that fun to listen to. I know that's not really the point, but eh, I just couldn't really get past it, and I couldn't really get into it.
Hey, that's why I need a one dance, got a Hennessy in my hand.
Likewise, this is Drake's most forgettable number one hit of the decade. I mean, it is kind of overhated. I don't really find anything to be really wrong with it. It's just kind of boring. I do like Drake's voice and some of the weirder production elements though. That's cool, and it adds a little bit of flair.
Oh, nah, nah. What's my name? Oh, nah, nah. What's my name?
Yeah, I don't understand why Rihanna and Drake's weakest collabs went to number one over songs like Take Care either. But I do find it surprising that none of them had a bad song touch the top of the charts this decade.
Champagne spilling, you should taste that.
I'm so fancy, you already know.
This hook is forever seared into my brain, and somehow I'm okay with that. What I'm not okay with is Iggy Azalea having a musical career outside of this year. I actually don't mind most of this song. It's probably just nostalgia talking, but eh, this never really sounded all that bad to me. Except for the bridge.
My ex-man brought his new girlfriend. She's like, oh my god, but I'm just gonna shake into the...
Yeah, this is kind of an affront to human decency, and it really does bog the song down a lot. But aside from that one main problem, there are a couple of other minor problems, such as the trumpet in the beginning, which kind of just sounds like an off-tempo fart. Luckily, they add some better percussion and brass instruments later, so it doesn't sound as bad or nearly as out of place. The entire lyrical sentiment kind of boils down to just, we don't like you, haters. That's pretty much it. But the best way to deal with haters in Taylor's case would just be to ignore them, but she keeps making songs about them, and I just feel like that's really not what she should be doing. So yeah, Shake It Off. It's somehow her biggest hit this decade, and while it is catchy, it is bogged down by a lot of small issues and that one big glaring issue, and it just kind of results in a mediocre experience. No. This is pretty much just a better version of Only Human by the Jonas Brothers. I mean, I don't really hate the way it sounds, and I don't really find it super unlikable or anything, but it does sound very, very cheap. Still waiting for Magic to just come back in a couple years with a random hit.
I came in like a wrecking ball. I never hit so hard in love.
We definitely drew the short end of the stick when it came to hits from Miley. And my suspicions were pretty much confirmed when I saw the MTV live performance of Slide Away. Of course, we had to stop giving her hits right when she got good. Come on.
Hey, it's Slide Away. Slide Away. Slide Away.
So say I'm in the middle of the road, not much to show.
It feels wrong that this is Justin Timberlake's biggest hit this decade, but somehow I honestly understand why it was. I mean, anything upbeat and catchy would have sounded refreshing in 2016.
Just gonna stand there and watch me burn. But that's alright, because I like the way it hurts.
This song is probably way too heavy and over dramatic for its own good, but that hook is iconic. This would probably be in the good tier if the chorus wasn't so repetitive and if Ludacris hadn't completely phoned in his guest verse. But once again, I have to point out that this went to number one instead of the superior hit, Dynamite, and it is a travesty. So decent tier it is.
Don't stop.
Classic, but definitely not her best. And it's a bit dated now. Still enjoy it though.
Hey! Raindrop, drip, drop top, smoking on cooking the hot pot. Cooking, fucking on your bitch, yeah, that.
Now, obviously, this song is a masterpiece. 5 out of 5. But Lil Uzi Vert is not good, and he holds the song back significantly.
Yeah.
He literally sounds like he just tried to eat a cactus, and I know that's rich coming from me, who has a really, really awful voice in general and is not good at recording audio at all. But come on, man, try harder.
Yellow, black. Ooh, black and yellow.
Black and yellow.
This being Calvin Harris's biggest hit over Slide or Feels is profoundly sad, but it's still a decent song. But sixth biggest hit of the decade? That might be overselling it a little bit. Okay, you can just take the placement of these next three with a grain of salt. I just wanted to put all of them at 69.
Hey, I'm a district in the
Surprise, surprise, all of the Latin-infused summer pop mega-smashes of the last 3 years happen to kind of be really fitting to put at number 69. I'm just gonna run through and say something quick about each of them. I like Cardi here, but her two friends there aren't even remotely in the same league. If Bieber wasn't on it, it would be in the good tier. Sean and Camilla have always had chemistry, but that doesn't change the fact that Camilla sounds like an alarm clock. This is by far the most frustrating number one hit of the entire decade for me, because the first half of this song is honestly really great. It's very solid, and I almost considered putting it in the excellent tier, but then, during the bridge, they do really bad dubstep.
Yeah.
Yeah, the bridge of the song pretty much grinds everything to a halt just to play this really badly produced and badly aged dubstep. I'm not kidding, this song would literally be in the excellent tier if the bridge was cut out and everything else was just left alone. I honestly think it's just that solid all around, but the bridge just really, really drags this one down for me. So yeah, a pleasant surprise, but also kind of a disappointment at the same time, which kind of averages out to decent.
She said, do you love me? I tell her only partly. I only love my bed and my mom, I'm sorry.
Biggest hit of 2018, I suppose. Honestly, considering that year's competition, it could have been much worse, so I'll take this.
When I see
Well, Bruno, I know what I would change. I would change the trajectory of your career right now, because we could really use you back on the charts in 2020, I'm just saying.
Baby, I don't need dollar bills to have fun tonight.
This being Sia's biggest hit is honestly disappointing, but it's Sia, so, you know, I'll take whatever I can get. How hot of a take would it be if I said that Charlie Puth's hook on this song is my favorite that he's ever done?
Cause I'm friends with the monster, the son of Muppet. Get along with the voices.
I still can't decide whether Rihanna or Juice WRLD had the better Eminem monster hook.
So where's your class if you are wrong in all the right ways?
Definitely one of Pink's best hits this decade, even if I don't know what half of the lyrics mean. This is pretty much just a worse version of Die Young, but I still like it, so here it is.
Hey, I just met you, and this is crazy, but here's my number, so call me maybe.
This has pretty much gone down in history as an all-time classic by now, but would it really hurt us to give Carly Rae Jepsen some more hits? Like, maybe some off of her latest album? Like, please? I mean, some of the songs on there are really good, like, come on. And yeah, that pretty much concludes part one. Stay tuned for part two coming whenever I decide to start writing it. And also after the summer ranking. Yep. Oh wait, there is still one more song.
And now it's time for Silly Songs with Laddie, the part of the show where Laddie comes out and sings a silly song.
Shardy!
So good.
Shardy's like a melody.